Hi, welcome to the Italian Culture Institute. Benvenuti a tutti, buonasera. This conversation is part of the Italian Creators of Our Time series. And tonight is the last one. And tonight we have Luca Rossettini and Mauro Nardocci, the founders of two companies specializing respectively in cleaning the sky, the orbit, the one of Luca Rossettini, and the oceans, the waters, and the name of this company, SEEDS, Sea Defense Solutions. The pollution of our planet is one of the most pressing and difficult problems of our society. About 8 million tons of plastic enter the sea every year, and at this rate, we foresee a future where in the oceans, there will be more plastic than fish by 2050. In the skies above us, there are at least 7,500 tons of space junk from old satellites. This represents a serious threat because of the risk of colliding with active satellites and or space stations, like in these days. Italians are pioneers in creating and implementing devices and technologies geared toward an environmental cleanup, greatly contributing much needed solution to this difficult and problematic issue. And before leaving the floor to Luca Rossettini, Mauro Nardocci, as usual, to Maria Teresa Cometto, I will ask our Consul General Francesco Generati, that organized together with us this series, to say something, please.
Buonasera, buonasera a tutti, grazie direttore, thank you director. It's a real pleasure for me to celebrate the end of this very important series of talks about creation, Italian creativity. It's a very good end of this first cycle. I guess it will be repeated, I hope, in the near future. Of course, we have to create now new things and have new creators that must come here, but I think it's a fantastic symbol, this last conference, about how much Italy attaches importance to science, to environment, and to a serious and very deep research on these very urgent, as you say, director issues. You know, in a few days we'll celebrate also la Giornata della Ricerca Italiana nel Mondo, April the 15th, and it's the anniversary of Leonardo da Vinci, of the 500 years, and for us it's important also to hold this conference here, Istituto Italiano di Cultura, because I think that this is a part, a very vital part of our humanistic culture, to be always at the forefront of the research, of the creativity, and to go beyond things. You are two fantastic young examples of startups, and you will explain in a while to us what is your job about, your creation. But I think that today we are celebrating how much Italy is at the forefront on these science, environmental issues. It's not just a matter of culture, but I think we have to focus more and more also as diplomatic representatives here in the United States, in New York, on science, on research, because Italy is not just a humanistic superpower, but also of science, and Leonardo da Vinci was one of the first creators of startups and these kind of things. And today we'll have also the demonstration that for Italy the sky is not the limit, because I hope that you will explain to us what you do also in the outer sky. Grazie a tutti e buona giornata della ricerca.
Thank you, Director, and thank you, Consul, for helping organizing this event. Thank you, Luca Rossettini and Mauro Nardocci, for being available. Can you hear me? Yes. Well, più vicino. April. Yeah. April is also Earth Month, so this is a fantastic occasion to celebrate our Earth. and to understand how to make our planet cleaner and to make our lives more sustainable. So let's start with the ocean, with Mauro. And unfortunately, let's start with a sad piece of news from Sardinia, from Italy. I don't know if you have read the piece of news. I'm going to read it. More than 48 pounds of plastic, including disposable dishes, a corrugated tube, shopping bags, and a detergent package with its barcode still visible, were found inside a dead sperm whale in Italy, the World Wildlife Fund said. The whale, a young female, washed ashore in Porto Cervo in Sardinia, and she was also carrying a fetus. She was a mom. And this was just the latest in a Grimm International collection of whale carcasses burdened by dozens of pounds of plastic trash. So, how bad is this situation, Mauro?
Okay, we start with an happy topic. So, welcome everybody. I think it's excruciating. The reality of our oceans is there are people. Then I mean, each of us has a different environmental, I would say, spirit or awareness and can care more or less. But this is going to touch not only, I mean, 3.5 billion of people directly depend on the oceans as primary source of their livelihood. So this is going to touch us very, very soon. If you have read, I mean, other news report as human beings have been proven that basically they start containing plastics. Because basically, yeah, because I mean, not only sperm whales eat our plastic, so every fish that is in the oceans is feeding out of what we're throwing there, and this is entering our food supply chain. Mm-hmm. We're eating it, we're killing ourselves with plastic straws, with the textile coming from our sweaters, from all the choices that we make. I've been working in the food industry for a long time, and I mean packaging plastic is still the only solution at the moment available. You step in a supermarket and you don't see many choices that are avoiding that, so it's very, very bad.
Let's go up to the sky with Luca. You have your mic. The MIT Technology Review wrote in the last issue that when India shot down one of its own satellites with a missile this week, the NASA administrator said, creating debris fields intentionally is wrong. If we wreck space, we are not getting it back. He was referring to the growing problem of space junk, dead satellites, leftover rockets, and debris from previous collisions that threaten operating satellites, human spaceflight, and even the International Space Station. Luca, how dangerous is all this? Is it dangerous also for us humans on the ground?
Well, let's say that we humans are experts on polluting, so not just the oceans, but the space as well. And the situation now it's dangerous. The European Space Agency mentioned that we are already over the threshold, so it means that the current activities that we are doing to avoid further pollution is not sufficient. So we need to go up and clean up what is already there. So the situation is dangerous. And the last event that you just mentioned just demonstrate that once again, we don't learn from our mistakes. So this was done by US at first, several years ago. They shot at their own satellite, creating debris. Then China shot to demonstrate that they have the same power as the US. They destroy a satellite that actually created 70% of the debris that we have in orbit now. And now India. So it's, you know, was not enough. So not US, not China, but now India. So situation it's growing, but also the number of satellites that we are sending in space is growing. So the original problem was not created by missiles destroying satellites, was created by sending up satellites and leaving them there as a waste after using them. Basically, we were, it's like we are driving in a highway, and then we run out of gas, and we are in the third lane. We leave the car and walk out. We take another car, we start driving, and then flat tire, and then we leave the car in the second lane, and then we walk away. Mm-hmm. Imagine that thousands of people start doing this on the same highway. Sooner or later, the highway will be not usable anymore.
Yeah.
So.
So you two have solutions, or you propose solutions for this problem. But before talking about your company and your innovation, let's talk a little about your background. You are both engineers. So what inspired you to get into this career, Mauro?
Well, I always had a firm passion for, I would say, the environment, specifically for the marine environment. I'm a computer engineer and a business engineer, so my background is a little different. I'm actually the communication expert of our company. The technical partner is another engineer. We both have this shared passion for the oceans. This is what brought us together. We worked together in Barilla, so in a previous life we met, and then this common passion brought us to work together in trying to solve this problem.
Mm-hmm. And you, Luca, when did you fall in love with space? I read that you were also an airborne officer, and you also dreamed of becoming an astronaut.
Yeah, let's say that I started dreaming about space when I was 5 years old. As probably many kids, I wanted to become an astronaut, and I kept dreaming to become an astronaut until I had the possibility to participate to the selection in Europe. And so we started in 10,000, but you know, if I'm here, it means that I'm not an astronaut, so something went wrong. But that actually was a motivation to start another company, to build my own spaceship and go to space on my own. And of course, first we need to solve the problem of space debris.
Mm-hmm. But why did you decide that was the problem to focus on? In the aerospace, there are so many different businesses.
Yeah. So basically, so my goal is to create a space transportation business, so orbital transportation business. So now you can read about colonies on Mars or on the Moon or on another planet, but it will never be possible if you don't create a logistics infrastructure in space. I mean, the Romans, so we are Italian, right? So the Roman Empire, when they conquered a territory, the first thing that they were doing, they were putting in place roads and transportation logistics. Otherwise, they couldn't have full control of the territory. So in space will be exactly the same. You need to have a logistics infrastructure. So that was my goal. But when? So you need a market. And it's very difficult to predict when the market will be there. So what we did, we created a roadmap, not based on technology, but based on markets. So we try to understand which market will be real in the future, step by step. And we ended up to today. And then we start thinking, okay, how can we start a project in a market at that time in 2011 when we started, where only big companies, like billion-dollar companies, were existing. We need to find a niche market solving a global problem, and that's how space debris pop up. So when I learned about space debris, I would say, yeah, that this is not possible that anyone is really thinking about. I said, oh yeah, nobody's really thinking about. So this is an opportunity. So that's why space debris.
And what is your solution? Apparently, it's not to destroy the satellites.
No, please, never destroy satellites. It's too dangerous. If you destroy a satellite, you actually increase the number of debris. So what we do, we invented a system that is a sort of intelligent motor that is totally independent from the satellite. So you can plug in this motor into the satellite. Either before the satellite goes into space or tomorrow into satellites that are already there. So they are already, let's say, orbiting around the planet. Once you have installed the system on the satellite can continue doing whatever it needs to do, so producing data, taking pictures or whatever. When the satellite is at the end of life, so usually when the fuel inside the satellite is gone, or the satellite for some reason is not working, my system wakes up automatically, detect that there is a failure in the satellite, and upon command from ground can remove the satellite. So we don't destroy the satellite. What we do, we bring the satellite down to Earth. Usually if the satellite is small, it will burn completely into the atmosphere, vaporize basically. If the satellite is big enough, we can direct the satellite in a proper area, so an ocean or into a desert. But, and this is, I mean, of course, this is not the most intelligent way, but this is what we can do today. The other solution is to push up the satellite into what is defined graveyard orbit. So it's a sort of wasteland. So we have a wasteland in space where we can put the dead satellites, waiting that in the future they can be, let's say, recycled in space to produce new satellites directly in orbit.
Fascinating, totally. Instead, SEED, what's the idea of SEED? And why did you decide to tackle this problem?
Our idea is, I would say, much simpler. It's intentionally much simpler because, especially in the areas, so we're talking of a problem about 7-8 million tons of plastic every year reaching the ocean. 7 million of these tons pass through the rivers.
Which rivers?
It's mostly the 10 big rivers that are two in Africa, the Niger and the Nile. And then there are a couple in India and Pakistan, which are the Hindu and the Ganges. Then there is the Mekong in Vietnam and 5 big rivers in China, Yellow River, Pearl River, Amur, Aihe. So it is massive rivers as large as 2-3 kilometers wide. Transporting, the biggest one is the Pearl River, and it transports almost 1 million tons of plastic every year to the oceans. Our solution is very simple. So are basically floating barriers that stop the plastic, accompany on a side of a river where it can be collected. And this plastic can be separated and transformed into a resource. So we can recycle, make money, so give job opportunities to the local communities, and also make them interested in maintaining the barriers. Because the point is, over time, the developed world has invested millions and millions in solutions in third world countries that have been basically the first, little technical problem they had. There was no interest of the local communities to maintain that, so they were just dismissed after a few years, 1-2 years. We are looking for a permanent solution, so we intentionally designed a very simple technological solution that requires minimum maintenance, has 100% collection effectiveness of the plastic, because it doesn't stop only the surface plastic, but also sink under the surface to stop all the plastic, and basically generating a positive virtuous circle that will also invite people to collect more plastic also from the inland and not only from the oceans in this separation plant that we're aiming to install.
Talking of the 10 most polluted rivers that bring all this plastic to the ocean, you know that the Italian explorer Alex Bellini is rowing on all these 10 rivers to document with videos and photos all this environmental disaster. Are you in touch with him? Are you going to collaborate with this initiative?
Alex is definitely a very inspiring public person, a character. We're in touch because his project is designed to create awareness for the problem, and clearly we're offering a solution. So we're in touch with his wife, which is basically taking care of the management and the communication. And actually, we're discussing how it's best to collaborate. We are having different options, but we definitely have a common shared dream. And we're working together to create something very soon. Either we will start with the communication, but also what they proposed us is also to invest part of the money that they are raising to start working and actually taking action and creating impact in these regions.
Great. Rightly, the Consul General mentioned that Italy is a country of scientists and not only navigators like Alex. In science, Italians are especially good in astrophysics, and in the industries, they are very good also in aerospace. In your opinion, Luca, why so?
Well, you give me an assist, so I want to take it. So I think you know the let's say the image of Italy outside of Italy, it's food, fashion, and but actually Italy was the third country worldwide to launch a satellite during the Cold War after Soviet Union and United States. So we started the aerospace, technology and knowledge long time ago. And initially NASA was coming to Italy to collaborate with Italy, not with the European Space Agency. So we have this in our history, and we are not really, commercializing this brand identity that we have. Why? But because I think we have a lot of creativity. We are dreamers, and space is dreaming. It's a creation. So I think this may be one reason. And most of the people that actually work with me, they are not coming. Of course, they want a salary, of course, but it's not just for the money. They come for the passion, because they think that they are doing something that is going to be useful for the future. So they feel that they are creating something. So I think this is the, the Italian nature in some way. Not only Italians, but especially in Italy, you can find it.
Mm-hmm. If I can add only one, because it's very inspiring. I think that more and more with the rhythm of the demands of current lifestyles, I think having a purposely driven existence and job is more and more important. We are very small, so we can't even offer a salary yet. And yet we have a lot of people that are reaching out to us and offering us to create a website, to design, to do technical designs for us. So having a vision, it's creating fulfillment for people. And I think the only way that we can solve these problems with this kind of size is only when people come together and people with the same visions come together and put together the resources. So I also take this opportunity to thank you everybody for creating this discussion.
When we started, because I was in your situation, so when we started the company, we were one.
Okay? Which year was it?
It was 2011. So we were one with no money. So I had at that time an industrial plan that was requiring 5 million euro as a seed investment, and I got 300,000 euro with exactly the same objectives. Okay, so that's so at that time I met former executives from a very famous aerospace company in Italy. At that time was Laben, that then became Thales Alenia Space, and I met the CEO of this company. And then the CTO and the head of engineering and production, by the way, Demetrio, is the reason why I'm here tonight. So they start talking to me. They start asking why. And I said, I explain why and what we want to do. And I said, this is impossible. So we are going to help you. And without them, the orbit wouldn't be here today. Mm-hmm. So, and they did it for free. Just investing their time, teaching to the young engineers, who were the only one that I could afford at that time, not what to do, but what they don't have to do. So giving them the possibility to exploit the creativity, but making sure that they were doing within boundaries and, that will not create mistakes that could be dangerous for the company. So.
Wow, that's a fantastic story. And so while we are with your story as a startup, I'm curious about your going back and forth America and Italy. Because you, in 2009, you won a Fulbright scholarship, and also you attended a course or something in Silicon Valley, California, right? and you also had an internship position at NASA. But then you went back to Italy to found the Orbit. Why not Silicon Valley?
The Fulbright scholarship really changed my life anyway. So when I decided to create a company, I was just an engineer. So like we had a PhD, a lot of, say, scientific knowledge, but zero business knowledge. I had a company at that time that was an engineering company. So it was easy. I was talking just to engineers. So I needed the business aspect, and I was lucky enough to win this scholarship. So I went to Silicon Valley. It was great, and I went to NASA as well. But also I learned at that time was 2009, so space was just government. And government means US citizens. So it's very difficult if you are not US citizen to work in the space. So at NASA, I had like the badge to go over the second fence, but only if one person come at the gate, open the gate for me, and then I step in, and then, you know, I was free to go everywhere. But still, you know, and I need to have some information that could not be given to me directly. So there were people talking outside of the window with me here, with her, and I was taking note. They were, of course, talking about the information that I needed. So, and I was working for them. So when I understood that, there was the second problem, finding money. So finding money to start a company that is quite capital intensive. Silicon Valley, there is a lot of money, but it was very specific for certain sectors. So software, biomed, pharmaceutical, and so on. No one was really investing in space, zero. So I said, no money in US for space, no money in Europe. But you know, in Europe, I have a chance to be among the first. And you know, my grandfather was used to say that it's better to be king of a small pot rather than no one into an ocean. And actually, it was right. So we had the chance to be in the niche market, the Europe into a niche market, and this gave us the chance to start growing the company. So that's why. And the last aspect is, when I start doing the first interviews in Silicon Valley, because at that time we had the company there. So I was interviewing this electronic engineer, very smart, amazing, from Stanford. So I asked to design an electronic board, and I couldn't even judge if it was good or not. It was, you know, was great to me. I said, okay, can you tell me if it can resist to vibration that usually you have to go through when you are launching into space? I said, no, I'm an electronic engineer, so you need a mechanical engineer. And I said, yeah, okay, but, you know, just like rule of thumbs, so just, you know, an idea, is going to sustain or not? I said, no, you don't understand, I'm an electronic engineer, you know, you need a mechanical engineer. But I couldn't afford...
Specialization is...
Exactly. It was great. The best engineers I ever met in all my life, but I couldn't afford two engineers. I have money only for one. So Italians are more flexible. They are less specialized, so they need to be trained a little bit more on what they need to do. But, you know, the guy that actually I hired, he said, well, I think he will resist. Give me a couple of days. And then he came back, we'd say, yeah, yes, he will resist.
Okay. More flexibility.
Yeah.
Was he Italian? The guy that you hired, was he Italian?
Yeah.
Mauro, at what point is the implementation of your project? I read that there was a prototype built by the University of Florence, the Polytechnic of Milan, and the University of West of Scotland, and was going to be tested in an Italian river. Has it happened already?
It will happen this Sunday. We will have some journalists there. We actually already, spoiler alert, we already done the test last week. Yeah, it was very effective.
But
yeah. It's, I mean, we actually came here the last year. We have been starting really testing our technology at different levels, before in an artificial channel where we could control the strength and the pressure of the currencies to see how it works in different river conditions. And we are collaborating, as you mentioned, with the University of Florence that has this laboratory at the moment. What we are doing is a modelistic process in which basically we are analyzing the strength that we will require to structure our barriers for rivers as big as the Nile or the Mekong. So this is, we have already tested, so the technology is ready. We're just creating this model that will allow us to perfectly design for the strength of the single specific river, and we're ready to scale up. We already have a couple of projects that we are basically discussing with public institutions, both in Italy and in Indonesia.
Can you tell us anything more about this project?
Yeah, I mean, it's nothing is closed, so it's just something that we're discussing, but the Ente Bacino, so it's the of Sarno. Sarno is a river in the Campania region. It's considered, rightfully so, one of the most polluted in Italy, and they have felt this need to reach out to us. So basically, we are designed already a project for them, and they're requesting fundings. In the meantime, we have also private companies that are offering us funds, so we might fund privately. And then there is the Citarum River, so in Indonesia, is the most polluted, is defined the most polluted river in the world. It's crossing through Jakarta. It's really one of the river you will see in any TV show when they show plastic pollution in rivers. Yeah, we already agreed with the governor of the Bogor region to install the first test barriers this year. We're basically there looking for funds, not always easy in Indonesia, but we're always working with private investors to fund also that project.
Great. And talking about the first funding came from a grant of the World Wildlife Fund, right?
Yeah.
And you started your company in this kind of incubator, Impact Hub in Milan.
Yes.
How was that experience?
Well, I have to say, I was not yet part of SEEDS. This came last year. But basically, we won a startup competition from the WWF that was held in 2017 for the most innovative solutions to defend the oceans. And that was created in partnership with Impact Hub. We have been working, so they have been consulting with us in recommending which kind of business model to create. They've been very supportive. At the moment, we are kind of detaching a little bit from them, but they've been very supporting and essential for the startup.
Great. Hiring, you mentioned the first engineer you hired. Now, how many are working with you? And is it easy to find the right candidates in Italy, or are you hiring also from abroad?
Yeah, so, well, today we are 54 people, mainly in Italy. We have 6 team in Portugal and, let's say, half a people in US, so that in the company that it's here in Washington. We have say most of the people in Italy are Italian. We have some people from abroad, so United States, UK, Belgium, Russia, and so on. So now they are coming also from abroad. So to find young engineers, it's pretty easy. So we receive many CVs every month from China, from US, from everywhere. The difficulty is to find, senior people with the right expertise that you need in that moment at the right salary level. That's the problem, because when you have a small company, the salary level that you can afford, it's not what you get in big corporations. So that's actually the problem. I have to say that the seniors that we have on board now, they decide to jump on board because they wanted to change their life. So they were sick of working in a big corporation, and they said, "Okay, no problem if I'm not getting the same salary level. If I start doing something with the purpose." That is what you were saying before. So there are still people that think that there is something more rather than money. Of course, it's not always like that. So expertise and seniority is more difficult than young engineers. Mm-hmm. And women, it's women engineers, very, very difficult, very difficult. We have 8 women in total in our company, so very small number. And when you reach to a certain level of seniority for a small company, it's even more difficult to find women that want to change and come here. This is something that we need to think in terms of probably education, so starting much, much before than reaching the companies. It's changing probably the situation, but at the moment we are really striving to find women, especially in some roles in which you need the creativity, a 360-degree capability that I think it's more... good in women rather than men. So managing programs, our women are the best, like 3 times better than any man that I have in the company. But it's very difficult to find them. So any women that want to work in space?
spread the word.
Yeah, please.
Going back to plastic, the European Union Parliament recently voted to approve a ban on many single-use plastic products, including disposable plastic straws, cutlery, and plates. Those measures are scheduled to take effect by 2021, I think. New York State also recently voted the ban on many plastic bags and so on. Do you agree with the ban, Mauro? Because I read a comment by your partner Fabio saying that the real problem is not the plastic per se, but it is dispersion.
Well, I mean, plastic, okay, to put it in perspective, plastic was invented 60 years ago. It didn't exist first. So, and it really helped in a lot of fields. So in preserving food, in medicine. I mean, we had a lot of used plastic. It's essential for our way of living. But yes, single-use plastic and the way we dispose of it, it's just unsustainable for our environment. And what we were discussing also before, I mean, we see all these straws and plates, but the largest amount of plastic that ends in the oceans are also microplastics. So these are microplastics that comes from our textiles. So when you wash in your washing machine, a Lycra sweater basically will lose these small tiny particles, and basically these will end up in the rivers and then in the oceans. And then it's impossible to recover. These will end up in the fishes and then in ourselves. So I definitely agree, it's a good step, definitely much needed. It's not solving the situation. So when the problem is this big, you need a lot of things to address it. This is a good step. I think it comes because the community is growing in terms of awareness and sensitivity to this topic. We had a call last week with the GIMARE, which is basically the technical part of the European Commission. They are investing and sustaining projects like ours for scaling it up. So it's definitely one of the big topics that the European Commission is working on. I definitely appreciate it. It's not enough, much more is needed.
Yeah, Luca, you earlier mentioned Mars. What do you think of of Elon Musk's plans to colonize Mars? And what about the competition between a SpaceX, his company, and Blue Origin by Jeff Bezos?
Yeah, well, as I said at the beginning, I think that we will have colonies sooner or later. So Mars could be one of these colonies. But if we project ourselves 500 years in the future, it's very difficult to understand which technologies or which companies will be there. 500 years is a lot of time. But definitely, we can have an image of our, let's say, humanity, right? So humankind. And if we survive to ourselves, it's likely that we will be in other planets. So it means that sooner or later, we need to start to get there, right? So maybe what Elon Musk is doing is the initial step. Maybe if he's successful, then others will follow and keep working for that. So regarding the competition, well, in space right now, yeah, this could be considered competition, but actually the market is expanding so rapidly at an exponential rate that actually it's very difficult for one company to gather all the market opportunities. Just to give you some numbers, we launched in 60 years of space, we launched 6,600 satellites in 60 years. In the next 5 to 10 years, we are going to launch 23,000 satellites. All of this, and this number is growing while we are talking, because the number of data that we are going to use on Earth is keep increasing. Imagine automatic cars, energy, oil and gas, even, you know, monitoring the pollution on the rivers, on the sea, and so on. So all these satellites need to get to space. So it's not just Blue Origin and SpaceX. There are a series of new launchers that are going to be created right now in China, in Europe as well, in US, in New Zealand, in Africa as well. So many companies will arrive with a system to put satellites in space.
So your company will have more and more work.
Oh yeah, definitely. That's you know, the more satellites to be launched, more satellites, because we what we are doing right now is also positioning satellites in space. We have a sort of FedEx truck that is our own satellite, and we can let's say position satellites in space. So more satellites to position and more satellites to remove at the end of life. So yeah.
I'm sure there are many questions from the audience. Okay. Is there a mic or?
Yeah.
Yes, and we can switch.
Giosetta Capriati. Yes, Luca, you are absolutely right. Italy used to be the biggest partner of NASA years ago. In 1996, I was working for the Italian Space Agency. That was the largest partner of NASA. Just in 1 year, we did 3 joint satellite launches, 2 from Cape Canaveral and 1 from Guyana, and I was there. Mauro, my question is for you. Among other things, I represent Mare Vivo in New York. Mare Vivo is an organization started 32 years ago by a wonderful Neapolitan woman, Rosalba Giugni, who is still the chairman. Mare Vivo was the first to launch a campaign against plastic 30 years ago. I have put Mare Vivo in touch with the United Nations, with the UN envoy for the ocean, because you know Secretary General Gutierrez 2 years ago appointed a UN envoy for the ocean, and it is Sir Peter Thompson, the former ambassador of the Fiji Islands to the United Nations. Mare Vivo has launched campaigns to create awareness about the pollution of the seas and the rivers also, and is also doing campaigns to clean the Italian beaches every year. But my question is the following. I don't know if you heard that last September, a Dutch architect launched this tube from San Francisco to swallow one of the 3 big plastic islands in the Pacific Ocean that are as large as Texas. The tube went into the ocean, started swallowing the plastic, but then the moment it was retracted, it spit the plastic. So it was a failure. But the Dutch architect is now trying to fix the problem. Your solution applies mainly to rivers. What are you going to do about the ocean? Because now, for instance, according to Mare Vivo, there is a plastic island in the Tyrrhenian Sea, and that's why the poor cetaceo landed where it did.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks for the question. It's definitely, it's completely to the point. We're actually also working together with Mare Vivo, as we share the same vision. The ocean cleanup was a failure. They collected $35 million and then they realized that the initial idea was technically unrealizable. So what I would say is extremely complicated to get the plastic out of the oceans, especially because after weeks, it really depends on the kind of plastic, but after some weeks and months, macroplastic becomes degrades into microplastic, and it's impossible to recover. That's why, I mean, I urge ourselves to do as much as possible to stop it before it gets to the ocean. I do not have, and I'm not aware of anybody that has a solution to get safely the plastic out of the oceans. Unfortunately, this is not a solution I have.
Professor Canuto?
I am a NASA scientist, but I must as well confess that I've been with NASA for more than 40 years. Here in New York, we have an institute. And I would like to make a point about the space debris, which you have not made, and which is a very serious one. In 1988, which means 30 years ago, I was advising the Holy See mission to the United Nations on scientific matter, and I suggested that we should talk about space debris. Rome accepted my speech. They said, this guy must be nuts. Who's talking about space debris? So when I gave my talk in a cold February day at the United Nations, I was received with the glacial reception. Now, space debris is item number one in the Special Political Committee in outer space. So in 30 years. But that's the time scale it took. But the reason why I gave that talk in 1988 is because of something that I would like to mention. Namely, that for some reason of physics, all these debris collect themselves at about 1,000 kilometers in space, as you well know. Now, that's not a magic number, it's 1,000 kilometers, so what's the big deal? The big deal I find out was that at that same location, there are, I don't know if 1,000, but certainly hundreds of nuclear reactors, Soviet nuclear reactors, during the Cold War. Because the Cold War, during the Cold War, the Russians wanted to follow the Navy, the US Navy. And of course, they couldn't do it on a stationary orbit because it's too far, so they had to be close to the Earth. The satellite. If you put a satellite close to the Earth, you must have solar panel. But if the solar panel is so large, with friction, it will fall down. So forget it. Solar energy is not good. So the Russian, the Soviet, as we should say at that time, used nuclear energy. It was the obvious solution. But see, Russian scientists were very good. They also realized that sooner or later, those nuclear reactors will end their lifetime. So what do we do with nuclear reaction? Well, they wisely decided to put them at 1,000 kilometers orbit without knowing, which they couldn't have, that there was the place where the space debris would have gone. So the coincidence of the space debris with this nuclear reactor would scare me, and still does. Suppose that one of those collide with one nuclear reactor, which actually in one case it did, and it almost fell into Canada. Fortunately, we were able to reactivate it and send it somewhere else. I don't remember exactly the details.
It fell.
But the point is that we have thousands of nuclear material over our head, and we keep on talking about Chernobyl and stuff like that, which is, you know, we are living with this 1,000 kilometer nuclear reactor on our head. That was the really scary, you're right to be scared, yeah. I'm still is. But I thought at that point it would have been a good coincidence, because it's purely coincidental. Nobody invented the 1 kilometer orbit. I mean, but that's a fact of life. It's something that I thought I would bring up because it's a funny thing, you know. It's a dangerous kind of thing to have a nuclear reactor in your head. The other remark I can make about the plastic, also many years ago, because I'm not exactly a spring chicken, I invited to the New York Academy of Sciences the Austrian guy who invented plastic. Was a very colorful man, extremely colorful man, who actually traveled from Austria to Italy walking. At that time, yeah. There was somebody in Germany that he didn't like, etc. So he was, and he invented the plastic. The chemist who invented the plastic. I forgot his name, but it's easy to find out. And anyway, everybody was congratulating him for doing this wonderful discovery. And he was very sober, and he said, yeah, but we don't, well, that was at least 30 years ago. He said, if you're not careful with what we do with plastic, we'll be drowned on it. And we are. And I remember very well that evening at the New York Academy of Science, which used to be here on Fifth Avenue, telling us that if we don't care about this plastic, that was marvelous because you have your glasses are all plastic. But if we're not careful, it's going to be our. And it turned out to be true that we have to. I must be confessed, I have no hope that we'll ever clean up the ocean, honestly. I work on the ocean 100% of my life, and honestly, I don't see how we can.
We know that we cannot clean the ocean, but I hope that we can do something about the nuclear thing. Oh. Do you have clients in Russia in those areas? Aren't you trying to?
So yeah, actually, what you said is true. In 1972, one Russian satellite fell into Canada. Yeah. 50 square kilometers were basically polluted by radioactive debris, and it's more than pollution. And actually, at that time, Canada sued Russia. To pay for the damages, but Russia couldn't afford it, so Europe basically helped and United States helped to clean up the area. So it's a serious problem. It's a serious problem, but when you said that now is the number one problem, unfortunately, it's true, but not even the governments and the institutions are really doing anything about. So let's be serious. I'm a company. I make money selling this device. Now I'm telling you a different story. I'm actually making money transporting satellites and not enough to survive selling this device. Why? Because even if we have rules, even if the regulations are changing, even in this case, institutions ask for waivers. So you are building a satellite paid with public money, and I said, yeah, but this satellite is not compliant with the current regulations. I said, yeah, but you know what? We start building 20 years ago, and the regulations were not here. I said, yeah, but the problem is here today. I say, yeah, you know, we will ask for a waiver and we will launch the satellite anyway. So number one problem, and let's say number 1,000 in terms of priority of applying solutions at the moment, unfortunately.
You can go on discussing afterwards. Just a second. More questions from there.
I think a short question regarding the plastic. Most of the rivers that you were talking about are heavily navigated by vessels carrying freight and passengers, whatever else. You mentioned that your device is a barrier. If it's a barrier, how does that affect navigation?
Yeah, good question. Well, actually, in the simplest version, it's only one barriers that going from one side of the river to the others. In the largest rivers, like the ones that we're discussing, actually is divided in two or more branches that basically cover the river, having a space that depends on the kind of navigations and ships that follow through the rivers. We have been in touch through the Italian embassy in Beijing with the Ministry of the Environment of China, and they clearly have billions of ships going through these rivers every single day. So this is one of the main topics that we're discussing. At the moment, basically, we are designing 500 meters distance from one part of the barriers to the other, so that it allows basically also the biggest ships that they have currently in these rivers to simply basically avoid the barriers. This is how we're designing it.
So building on the same question, how these barriers affect life in the river? Because I imagine as well, that's something I'm sure you evaluated already.
So. Yes. For the little life left, yeah, I mean, actually these barriers are just floating barriers. They sunk 1 meter, so there's just no effect. It doesn't affect at all to the fishes in the rivers. So fishes have extraordinary variety and diversity. In some specific rivers, 99.999% of the fishes deposits their eggs on the ground. In very specific case, might happen that there are some that have reproductory strategies that have eggs that basically floats on the water, but it's normally that small that is not blocked by our barriers either. So we have a marine biology involved in our team that will carry over basically analysis on the specific environment of each case, but at the moment we haven't seen any problem in that.
Regarding plastic in the ocean, how far does the plastic in the major rivers, is it dumped directly into the rivers or is it coming more upstream? And is there other methods by which to catch it before it gets to the larger waterways? But I've seen some methods in Australia and some other countries where they're catching these things in the smaller tributaries before they enter the larger rivers.
Yes, so it really depends. Clearly, the more population, so big city centers that are basically the rivers goes through, it's normally a big source of plastic pollution. It really depends on how this specific city organized basically the collection of the plastic or their waste in general. In Australia, they are trying to have some nets at the end of basically the cities. It's normally a solution that definitely could diminish the problem, but this is a problem that is accumulated by industrial pollution. In many cases, it's are debris that basically are brought there from the rain that basically channels also waste that is not in the river. Then in, you know, I mean, the conditions of the river can be affected heavily by floods, especially in this Southeast Asia region, in Asia. So there's a variety of ways in which plastic reaches the rivers. One of these ones that we were mentioning before, washing machines. I mean, that's a very simple, there exists already a technology, a filter that could be applied to all your washing machines. It costs $30-$40. It would be super easy to be required as a demand for the producer to be installed in each one, but we're not doing it. So it's a combination of factors. There are some technologies that could limit some of these factors, but I mean, the size of the problem is that massive that we're trying to shoot for the biggest bird, let's say.
Yeah, here, first.
So I want to go back to space, and you talked already Bezos and Musk, and then there's also Branson, and they also want to do space tourism. So initially, maybe just touching the edge of the atmosphere, but then perhaps going a bit beyond that and staying up there for a day or two or whatever. So then the issue will also become very, very important that there's debris. And when you have a family going up, because that's great, everybody wants to go in space now, maybe in 5 years or so. Obviously a bit expensive, but still. So more should be done. And maybe those companies should also be interested in providing some funding.
Yeah, exactly. So the you hit a very good point. So the real driver of a change is really these new commercial companies. All these companies that want to bring people in space. There's also a U.S. company called Bigelow Aerospace. Bigelow is the founder of Budget Motel. Now he created his own space companies. He wants to send warehouses in space to be rented for hotels or, let's say, production facilities in orbit, whatever. And he already launched one. Now he's launching the second one. And so all these commercial companies will have this issue. So when we start talking with one of the largest potential constellations of satellites, so constellation is like series of satellites, so hundreds of satellites that are going to be put in space. At the beginning, they were saying, you know, space debris, okay, who cares, right? So we are not here to save the trees. We are here to make money. But then they realize that the dead satellites in the same orbit of satellites that are still alive are creating issues because you have the other satellites have to avoid the collision in order to, you know, keep doing their job. And so you sacrifice fuel and time, so you sacrifice revenues. And this is a problem. So they start thinking about solutions. So now they are thinking to lower a little bit the satellites and also to have someone else going after, bring those dead satellites and remove them. So it's really, it's not yet, let's save the trees. It's, I have a need, a personal need, or my company has a need, then I will also save the trees. So this will help to speed up the process of, let's say, helping also the space environment to be more sustainable. And even if space looks very far from our activities, remember that today we depend on space. 70% of the technology that we are using come directly or indirectly from space. Emerging countries cannot survive without space data. So we cannot live anymore without satellites. So we need satellites in the day-by-day life.
Very interesting. A question over there.
Hi there. My name is Pino Fortunato. I'm the founder and executive director of a nonprofit here in New York, Eco Art Project. We increase awareness about environmental issues through art and design projects. Going back to plastic, I It's really hard to imagine the amount of plastic that has been dumped into the oceans and still comes also through the rivers, that it's just by simple human activities, like, and not municipalities' activities, like actually trucks and entire containers for years and years and years have been authorized by governments to go in the ocean and just dump it there because it was the easiest solution. And same thing in the rivers around the world. And probably just also in Italy and news also in Campania, it's just not in India. And it's in Naples and everywhere else. So how much is actually there being done by the government to actually stop that activity? Is it somebody actually lobbying against that, or why not to go straight to the cause instead of the consequences?
So, as I was mentioning before, there's actually no one single cause, but it's true that, I mean, simply the practice of dismissing waste, especially in these countries, especially in developing countries like Indonesia, Vietnam, Philippines, it's quite wild. So for sure that could be an education element, because, for example, Indonesian government is actually extremely committed to reduce the problem at the moment, because they have been ashamed in basically worldwide, because there were all these, I think, I don't know if you're aware, but there were a couple of French tourists that went to Bali, so ideally one of the paradise in the world, and they found these terrible situations of a river polluting the ocean, and basically it went viral. And so that's why we are actually working with the government there. But there are
because it affected tourism.
It affected tourism. Yeah, partially also fisheries, but tourism is the biggest is the biggest industry there. And they're trying to solve it, but also putting regulations in place doesn't mean that the local population will basically follow these regulations, because I've been living in Southeast Asia for a while, and I'm not saying it's complicated. So for sure there is an activity of working with the governments in order to put in place the best possible regulations. As I mentioned before, not even European Union or the US, for example, have a regulation that demands washing machine to have filters. But the same, I mean, for sure there is a path, a progression that can be done with these governments, but it's easier with some governments. So China is very committed as well in going towards the sustainability, because they're reaching a point of, there's nothing beyond. I mean, their environment, it's unlivable. So there are steps taken in this direction, but my perception is it will take several years before, I would say, correctly dismissing waste. And we're looking at forecasts that this plastic will double by 2035 and quadruple by 2050. So we're talking an even higher and bigger problem. So it's not something I see a very easy solution in this direction.
If I may add one comment. So it's not that the institution, my opinion, it's not that the institution do not want to do something. It's the difference between willing to do and do it. So in the day-by-day activities, even in the institutions, everybody has a budget, has a time limit, a deadline of the project that they are working on. So eventually, you know, if you ask everybody, say, oh yes, you know, like plastic in the river, it's crazy. Why we are polluting? Why we don't do something? And the space is the same. So why we are, you know, leaving the satellites there? But actually, when you are working on the day-by-day on your satellite, then eventually say, oh yeah, but I have a limited budget. I have no more money to put the system, you know, to make sure that the satellite will remote. Well, you know, it will be a problem for someone else. So it's not that there is a lack of will. It's sometimes it's like more strict procedure that we need. So regulations are becoming more and more strict, but I mean, we don't need just regulations. We need also clear procedures to apply the regulations in the day-by-day activities of everyone, and not just at government level of like United Nations.
And maybe there is also need for education, especially in certain countries, because people must understand that you cannot throw away plastic bottle like
that's
that.
For sure. But I wanted to add the points, since also the it was raised before. Actually, in Italy, the problem that Mare Vivo identified, so the association we're working with, and then the lady actually pointed out before, is that nobody wants to pay for the plastic collected by a system like ours. So basically, for the current regulation, if a major decide to install our barriers, they will collect plastic. But it's not just the plastic that has been created by their basically citizen, but also all the cities that have been polluting all over before the basically the city. So at the moment, the current regulation requires for the collector to pay for the dismissal of waste. And this is clearly a budget problem that is, I would say, at least delaying the installation of our barriers in Italy.
More questions? Over there.
Mauro, I think you develop a fantastic idea, and I think it's really a great solution that you have. However, you mentioned just a few minutes ago that the problem is just going to exponentially grow, double, triple, quadruple. So I would like to understand, what are your strategies to scale up this idea and really be able to make an impact?
Yeah, I mean, the best part is that we're just 10 barriers away from stopping 90% of this plastic. And the 90% will stay the same even if you grow the absolute amount. So it's not requiring a massive investment, because we're talking about barriers that we intentionally decide to be very affordable. It's not requiring any particular technology. And every barriers could be created and installed in maximum 4 to 6 months from the start of the project to the installation on the river. So actually we could have an impact regardless of the size of the growth of the plastic that we expect. It's that's the beauty, I think, of the solution. I hope I answered your question.
The more plastic you collect, the more money you make.
Well, it's, if you want to put it like this, yes. It will, it's simplistic. You will, we are looking actually to use the collaboration of system to dismiss waste that are already existing. If not present, yeah, we will install plants.
I just wanted to go back to the space topic for a second. It looks like this new space age is actually being triggered by these private companies developing reusable rocket technologies. That's where you mentioned before, space exploration, interplanetary bases, colonies are going to largely depend upon. Now, I wanted to ask you, is there anyone in Europe developing these technologies, or is it just something that American companies are bringing forward?
So you mean reusable rockets?
Correct.
Okay. So I'm actually, my background is in propulsion. So it's definitely a reusable rocket, make some savings, okay? But not enough to justify the big research and development behind this technology. It's very complex technology. If you watch the videos of SpaceX at the beginning, all the failures that they had, it's really, really complex, right? You wanted the rocket from space, go through the atmosphere and control the rocket that it's actually tumbling and going like a crazy, and then ended up like something that is very long and very thin, ended up exactly standing on his small edge. It's very, very, very complex. So the real point is why Elon Musk decided to go for that technology. Is for just saving money, or is for developing technology that will allow him to land on Mars and then come back? This is my opinion. Eh? But if you want to land on another planet, then you need that technology. If you want to go with the rocket, as he's thinking to do, then you need this technology exactly to land and to start again. Then, of course, on top, you need to justify from an economic point of view the reason why you are developing that technology. So that's why you have that system. But said that, after Elon Musk demonstrated that it was possible, because at the beginning everybody was were laughing about this technology. Oh, that's you know, it's not convenient, it's more expensive, why they are doing that. Now all the rocket companies are thinking to introduce that technology in Italy as well as in many other countries in Europe, so as well, but not just in Europe, in China as well.
Any more questions?
One comment about plastic. You know, the biggest failure of humanity nowadays is to tackle the global warming. Okay, that's I think that it's a given. In 1992, there was the first meeting of the Earth Summit in Rio de Janeiro. In 2012, there was the Rio Plus 20, in which every nation declared that they were not able to do anything. For whatever reason, we haven't done anything. It's a global failure of government to tackle the problem. But I'm afraid that the plastic invasion, if you can call it that way, will make the global warming even worse. Because perhaps you didn't think about that, but I'll suggest the following scenario. 40% of the carbon dioxide that we emit in the atmosphere is thankfully absorbed by the ocean. Thank God we have the oceans that absorb that. Yeah. Otherwise, it would be like in Venus, we'd be cooked to death. Okay. So the ocean is doing the Samaritan job of helping us. As a thank you note, we are polluting the ocean. Okay? We're putting all this plastic. This plastic, sooner or later, is going to lower the ability of the ocean to absorb carbon dioxide. Okay? Simply because the phytoplankton at the surface, which was this mini creature that do this wonderful job of chewing up CO2, will not be able to do it because of the plastic present there. So I see deterioration of an unsolved problem, which is global warming, caused by another human problem, that is the plastic. So since we are here giving bad news, we might as well tell the truth.
Well, actually, instead, I'm much more optimistic, having learned that we have positive people thinking of solutions. Luca, you want to make a last remark?
A positive remark. Something that was originated in United States, and it's not about only plastic or space. It's about business. It's the benefit corporation model. So benefit corporation concept was invented in United States to allow for-profit companies to make money and have a positive impact. Okay, and this model actually was exported, and now Italy is the first nation after United States to have a law that allow companies to become a benefit corporation, so both to make money but also to have a positive impact. And in Europe, this is spreading. So Germany and France are learning what Italy did. And so I think that in the future, no matter which sector we are going to work, if it is plastic, if it is space, or it is raw material or whatever, this model of benefit corporation will basically substitute the normal for-profit. Because we have for-profit with a purpose that is even more powerful. And people that buy products and or buy services, I mean, we are not stupid, right? So we understand what is good or not. If we buy the same glass from two companies, but one is having a positive impact, at the same price, I will buy, you know, the good one. Yeah. So I think this is going to generate a positive reaction and change more rapidly what today seems almost impossible.
Yeah. By the way, in the audience, there is a champion of impact investing and a big corporation, Paolo Cugnasca, forestry. So we will follow the news about your experiment this yes. weekend, right? And my last question, I'm curious, how are you going to celebrate the landing on the moon?
Well, so about a few weeks after, we are going to have a launch of our satellites, full of small satellites that we are going to deploy with the system, the big satellite that is able to remove it once again. So this will be our celebration. So going to the moon is not something that is going to stop, so it's going to continue, hopefully in a more sustainable way.
Fantastic. Thank you so much. Thank you.